Hello and welcome to Lighthouse Church Online once again as we continue to deal with the effects of the quarantine. We hope that this finds you well and that you are finding the time to be actually a little productive and maybe some sweet time with family as well in the midst of all of this. You remain in our prayers, whether near or far, and we ask that you keep us the same. Let us begin with a word of prayer, and then we will dive into the word. So let's pray. Father God, we do thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for your son. We thank you for the Easter story of last week, of his resurrection. And we pray that you would bless this time now, and that you would bless our efforts to understand, that your spirit would move, that we would have ears to hear, and that your word would move us to action. And we thank you. We thank you for the privilege and the joy of being in your word and the technology that makes it possible during this time. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, as we get started, we're going to jump into John 21 at the end of John. And we are going to come into a story that, to me, is more than just a postscript at the end of the book. It is a very, very special story. And it has a great impact, not only in the life of a man named Peter, but in our lives as well. As we approach this story, we have gone from the highest of highs to as Jesus entered Jerusalem and the disciples must have thought, surely the kingdom is coming, to the lowest of lows, all through uncertainty and doubt and fear, to the highest of highs once again as Jesus showed himself to be risen. And John had summed up Jesus' proof of himself being raised, even to the doubting Thomas, with this sentence: "These things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that believing you may have life in his name." That is the purpose of this book. And this story is one last illustration of that purpose. That purpose that has been focused on Christ's identity throughout the book of John, through what he has done, who he is, and our relationship to him, that we might believe. And we approach it, as John tells it, really from the point of view of Peter. You know Peter. Peter was the hard-charging leader. He was one of the oldest disciples. He was the man that all looked at as the heir apparent. And he was a great example of that strong personality that so often has a hard time not only forgiving the issues in others, but oneself. Sinclair Lewis once remarked that forgiveness is a lovely thing, unless one has something to forgive. Quite often we have a difficulty forgiving others, even where we can accept it, but those personalities that are truly driven so often have trouble accepting forgiveness. And let me tell you, any person who has trouble accepting forgiveness has trouble beginning the most basic relationship with Christ, because we have to accept forgiveness so often before we can even grant it. And Peter is a perfect example of one of those people that has to accept forgiveness of his own faults before he can grant it, before he can learn the depths of it, before he can share it with the world. How can Christians share forgiveness with the world if we've never really come to realize our own sin and accepted forgiveness for it? That's one of the problems that I have had as a Christ follower, accepting Christ at a young age, that others have had in their lives, coming to the true depth of our own sin and realizing how much we need forgiveness when we've seemingly always had it. And that is, in a great part, what Peter is coming up against here. We know Peter, that leader, that strong, driven personality that claimed, even as they sat around the table and they reclined and Christ recounted who would betray him, that his disciples would run, that they would dissolve in the face of adversity. And Peter looked at them and rather disparagingly said to the Lord, "Even if all these desert you, I won't. I will be here." Think about that. That is a prideful statement. "Even if all these desert, I won't, because I'm faithful." Peter was the only one who tried to defend Christ. The garden filled with torches. The soldiers were there. The religious leaders had come. Their slaves were there. A mob was there to arrest Christ. And Peter drew his sword in the face of the mob and struck one slave, cut off his ear. Christ reproved him, healed the ear, and surrendered. And Peter fled with the rest. That night, he tried to get close to his Savior. He wanted to know what was going on with his rabbi, with his teacher. If you can imagine it, Peter huddles around the fire, and what happens? "Weren't you with him as well? Aren't you one of his disciples?" "No, I am not." A second time, someone asks him, "Weren't you one of Jesus' disciples?" "No, I'm not." And a third time, "Weren't you with him too?" And it says that he answered with an oath, "I do not know the man." Fear rose up in him and he denied the Lord. A fear that drove him in shame into the night. We don't know where Peter was exactly standing and all that during the crucifixion. But imagine him unable to even quite approach the foot of the cross because of the shame of having denied his Lord. He watches it from a distance. He goes and hides with the rest of the disciples until one morning, that first Easter morning, Mary rattles the door. The Lord's body has been taken. He and John race to the grave. John believes a miracle. Peter unsure. Fear, doubt, shame. And then the risen Lord. Jesus appears and proves to them all that he is alive. And Peter rejoices with them, but there's something in the back of his mind. There's a shame there that he just cannot quite remove. If you think about his position, a man who's never known shame a whole lot in his life, one of the chosen people, the hard-charging guy, the responsible leader, and now he is wrecked, unsure. Christ leaves them. He and the disciples know that the Savior is risen, but now they don't know what to do. They stand around, they sit around, they talk, they look at each other, and Peter finally comes out with a decision because he is the decisive man. We don't know if it was so that he could feed his family or just keep his hands busy. We've all been there. And he says, "I'm going fishing." He returns to the one thing he truly knows, and he goes fishing, and the other disciples go with him. Imagine that picture. They get out, they cast the net into the water, and through the night they fish. Through the night, they seek just one lousy fish, and they don't find anything. As the early rays of the sun begin to dawn, begin to cut through the fog that lays on the lake, as figures appear dimly in the distance, someone stands on the shore, and they call, and they say to Peter and to the other disciples, "Do you have any fish? Do you have any fish?" "No, we don't have any fish." In Peter's mind, can you imagine the self-doubt that had to be creeping in at this point? "I can't even catch a fish." And he most certainly did not stand with his Lord. "No fish." But the voice calls back, "Cast the net out. Throw it out on the right side of the boat." Okay. They throw it out on the right side of the boat, and a familiar sensation starts to overcome. That sensation of the net filling and tugging. They begin pulling on it. It is filled to capacity. It should be breaking, and it isn't. As they're pulling it in, something dawns in the mind of John, and sitting next to Peter, he says, "That's the Lord." And Peter, having worked all night in a state of not much clothing, you know, and just dressed for work, grabs his outer garment, wraps it around him, and dives into the water. He's been away from the Savior too long. Can't take it anymore. He swims into shore as the other guys bring the boat in, hauling in all the fish. Already there are a couple of fish on the fire. The Savior is ready to feed them all. And he says, "Bring in the rest of the fish." And they have a meal. And at the end of that meal, in chapter 21 of John, verse 15, we find this exchange between Jesus and Peter, as Jesus so kindly draws Peter back to himself. And he says to Peter, "Do you love me?" Now think about what's going on in Peter's mind as he has been through all of what he's done. The shame is overwhelming. He just wants to be close to Jesus. And Jesus asks him, not just, "Do you love me?" But look at verse 21, chapter 21, verse 15 with me. "And when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these do?'" Now we know that from the Last Supper, he had said he loved Christ more than the other disciples. There is some discussion on what "these" refers to. Do you love me more than these things, you know, fishing and all that? Or do you love me more than you love these other disciples? But what fits here is, do you love me more than these other disciples do? Peter's answer to that question shows some growth in the time as he replies, "Well, yes, Lord, you know I love you." He doesn't say he loves him more than the other disciples do. He just says, "You know that I love you." Jesus told him, "Feed my lambs." Jesus said a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He replied, "Yes, Lord, you know I love you." Jesus told him, "Shepherd my sheep." Jesus said a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was distressed that Jesus asked him a third time, "Do you love me?" And so he said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus replied, "Feed my sheep. I tell you the solemn truth, when you were young and tied your clothes around you and went wherever you wanted, but when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and others will tie you up and bring you where you do not want to go." Now Jesus said this to indicate clearly by what kind of death Peter was going to glorify God. After he said this, Jesus told Peter, "Follow me." After breakfast, they take a walk. And this is the exchange. The significance of three times is often compared to the significance of three denials. That Jesus asks Peter, "Do you love me?" The first time, do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than these do? And Peter's answer, Lord, you know I love you. I can imagine in the back of his mind that guilt rearing its head. But Jesus has forgiven Peter, and he is restoring Peter in a way that is something greater than Peter ever could have imagined. Peter, the man who denied Christ three times, will be Peter, the man who preaches and the thousands come to know the Lord as Savior. Thousands. Peter will be the leader who leads the disciples in turning the world upside down, and he will be the first one to go to Gentiles and bring them to his Savior. But there's a question that has to be answered here. And Peter is grieved by this question. I imagine the first time he felt the significance of it and kind of had an almost tentative answer, yes, you know that I love you, almost trying to reassure himself. And Jesus gives him a threefold call as he asks him these questions and finishes with the thing that he first said to Peter. Follow me. At the beginning, Jesus had filled their nets to the breaking point, and their nets had started to break when he had first called these disciples. It was eerily similar to this moment when he said, follow me and I will make you fishers of men, and they followed him. Now, here he is giving the directions to Peter as to what he wants him to do, how he's going to fish. And he's restoring Peter at that same moment. Forgiveness is a lovely thing. It's a lovely thing when we accept it. And then it's a lovely thing when we proclaim it and give it. They say it's easier to receive forgiveness than to give it, but sometimes I think that's quite the other way around. It's easier to give it than receive it. And if we're unwilling to receive it, well, that personality that can't receive it sees that there needs to be judgment for others as well and has a hard time even giving it. Forgiveness is an amazing thing. People can forgive extreme slights against them, crimes, issues, and yet sometimes they have issue accepting it themselves. And that, I believe, is part of the issue here with Peter. He longs for that forgiveness. He wants it. But how to receive it? And Christ gives it freely. Jesus doesn't ask him three times to torture him. He asks him three times to teach him. Think about this. If you are a believer, you are called to these three things, this charge, in some form or another, that Christ gives to Peter. Now, this is Peter's specific call, but it is something that all of us share. Do you love me? You know that I love you. Jesus told him, feed my lambs in verse 15. Think about that statement. Feed my lambs. I believe that this is an encouragement to him that Peter can hear the echoes of in his own experience. When the disciples approach Jesus at the well in a Samaritan town, and he was speaking to a Samaritan woman, and she departed into town, and those disciples were wondering, what in the world is Jesus doing? And they brought him the food that they had secured for him, and he said to them, I have food you know nothing about. You think that echoed in the mind as he encouraged him to feed his lambs. what was that food? To do God's will, Jesus told his disciples at the time. And then he went on to explain to them that while they might say the harvest was coming at a certain time, he said, look up and the fields are white with harvest. And he pointed up at a town in which people were coming out of the town to see them. I believe this is the call to spread the gospel, to do the work, the will of God. The fields are white with harvest. Feed my lambs, bring the gospel, and take care of the young believer. Then he says, you love me. Simon, son of John, do you love me? He replied, yes, Lord, you know I love you. Jesus told him, shepherd my sheep. Peter has a special call to guide the body of Christ in the absence of the Savior. With the leadership of the Holy Spirit, he is going to be the top leader in Jerusalem, leading that church. He's been given a charge to shepherd God's people. Then again, one more time, Jesus said a third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was distressed that Jesus asked him a third time. He said, Lord, you know everything. He knows my good, he knows my bad, he knows everything. And almost like he's trying to convince himself, you know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. How do we feed the sheep of God? Through his word. And I believe that that was the charge being given to Peter. Take care of my lambs. Reach the world. Shepherd my church. Feed my sheep. And then he says to Peter this prophecy. When you were young, you did what you wanted. But when you're old, other people are going to take you where you don't want to go. And he signified Peter's death. Peter was martyred for the cause of Christ. We don't know for historical fact exactly how. The church legends are that he was crucified. Church legend holds that he actually demanded to be crucified or requested to be crucified upside down because he couldn't stand to be killed the same way as the Savior. Didn't feel himself worthy. We don't really know for sure other than he glorified the Lord to his death. And Jesus finishes with that first statement that he introduced himself to Peter with in the Bible, follow me. Follow me. Christ is calling you. He calls me. We as Christians, if we are believers, have a responsibility to follow him. We have a responsibility to spread the word to the non-believer, because we believe their eternity hangs in the balance. We have a responsibility to help guide the body of Christ as we grow and we mature, and we have a responsibility to shepherd those who he places under us in discipleship, whether it's our children or someone that we have the privilege of leading to the Lord, or as a pastor, a church. This is the call to God's servants. Has God ever asked you to do something? Has God ever asked you to step out and you ignored it? You know where Peter was. He had been given the opportunity to stand with Christ and he had denied it. Some of you have been called to ministry and you've stepped away from that because you have your reasons. Fear of what you might lose. Fear of what your family might lose. Fear of, you pick it, you name it. Some people do equate ministry with any calling on their lives, and I don't want anyone to think that you have to be in full-time ministry just because Christ has laid a call on you to do something. Oftentimes when people grow in the Lord, they assume that they're called to full-time ministry simply because they're growing. That's not the case. But have you ignored the call you've been given? Were you called to lead a Bible study? In our case, you know, I've had many things that I have fought with the Lord on and ignored him on. We were called to plant a church. It's one call we followed, and we've been blessed extremely through it. But it's a scary thing to trust the Lord. It's a scary thing. Why? Because we want to trust in ourselves and what we can control. Peter's one of those people. And so he had retreated in fear from the calling that had been placed on him. And now he's having a new calling placed on him with forgiveness for missing the old. If you've had Christ's call on you, whether it's to worship in a certain church or to reach a family member with the gospel, to step out of your own isolation, or to jump into full-time ministry, there is forgiveness if you've missed that opportunity. And there's a greater opportunity ahead if you will only take it. If you are the non-believer, the person who God is simply asking you to come to him, know that even the one who has denied him had a chance to come back. Not just come back, but to be one of the greatest leaders of the church ever. The man who had the opportunity to serve the Lord. What an amazing thing. Your call may be a simple thing. It may be a complex thing. It may be as simple, as I said, talking to a neighbor, or as complex as changing your vocation. It may be as simple as coming to Christ and trusting him as Savior, follow me. It may be as deep as take a risk and jump in feet first into you don't know what, follow me. But the call is the same. The forgiveness we need is the same. And Peter demonstrates it for us so wonderfully. John included that story not because he was running Peter down, but because he was shoring Peter up. To later believers, they would understand Peter's leadership. They would understand the special call on Peter, and they would understand Christ's call to them. These things are written that you might believe. John just didn't randomly throw this story on the end. This is part of that capstone. This is the illustration. He copies the Savior by giving the lesson and illustrating it. These things are written that you might believe. Follow Christ. Follow me. This is the call on Peter's life. This is how we finish the book of John. We've gone through the identity of Christ. We've gone through his work, his death, his burial, his resurrection. Do you believe? These things are written that you might believe. What's he calling you to follow? Is he calling you to take a risk and heal a relationship in your family? Is he calling you to take a risk and jump into ministry? Is he calling you to take a risk and to trust him for the forgiveness of your sin? Follow me. Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for your forgiveness and your call. Lord, we pray that as we focus ourselves on you, as we learn to love you, we would learn to love others. As we learn to love you, we would learn to follow you. And following you, we would know you better. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you very much. Have a blessed day.